are going to be focusing on women's clothing. And some of you may have wondered why clothing. Fashion is sometimes considered to be light or frivolous, but costume is actually just as much a part of the historical record as a document, say, like the Declaration of Independence. Clothing is an intensely personal expression of a moment in time. Now, while we might not consciously think of it in that way, every single one of us participates in that expression daily. Your stylistic choices are a reflection of who you are or who you see yourself to be. And it's been that way since people first started wearing clothing. The fabrics you wear, the accessories you choose, even whether you decide to follow trends or not, all of these offer clues to those around you of who you are in your time. Now, Susan Wheeler was a lady of fashion. As Chris said, she was the daughter of Luke Wheeler, who was mayor of Norfolk in 1805. Now, this portrait is from 1803, when she was about 27 years old, and just a couple of years before she met Navy hero Stephen Decatur, who eventually she would marry. And we know from the record of those who knew her, I mean, obviously from the picture, she was beautiful. She was also very well thought of, well educated, and apparently quite charming, because the rumor is that she rejected the likes of Vice President Aaron Burr and Napoleon Bonaparte's brother, Jerome. She provides us a great opportunity tonight because her birth date and the period of her courtship and marriage to Stephen Decatur offer us a very convenient opportunity to show you the range of garments that would have been worn by a society lady during this period. Now, by way of disclaimer, we are not aware of any extant garments owned and worn by Susan Wheeler Decatur that exist today. We're going to show you a general idea of the items the clothing that was fashionable during this time period. So it's probably a good approximation of what she would have worn, but we don't know for certain exactly what she wore. This period of time that we're going to be talking about, the early 19th century, was a revolutionary time in fashion. So before we get into the clothes of this time period, we'd like to put them in context for you by going back to what clothing looked like when Susan was born in or around 1776. We actually don't know all that much about her childhood. We're not even sure who her mother was, but we do know she was born around 1776, and that gives us a good starting point from which to give you an idea of just how radical these changes in clothing were.
So just a big 360,000 foot view here. When Susan is born, we're in the neoclassical period. Art and architecture is heavily influenced by ancient Greece and Rome. There's discoveries in Pompeii and Herculaneum. All of these amazing artifacts are coming to light, in addition to the political upheaval and the social upheaval that's happening at this time. And you're going to see some things in these ancient influences show up later in some of the examples that we're going to show you today. The sculpture at the far right of this screen, the Triton, you can see is an empire waist. The drapery is very clinging to the body. It's a very natural form. And even in the bust of the head, some of the hairstyles that you might actually see us wearing today are reminiscent in this the ancient work you're seeing here, too. This is a portrait of the artist Copley, who was very well known for symbolism in clothing and in his paintings. And I just wanted to show this for you because we're going to talk about children's clothing in a moment. And if you see this little girl that's looking right at you in the middle of the photo, she's kind of telling you this is what's to come. And there's a lot of symbolism in the art and architecture. We don't have time to jump into it, so I'm going to very quickly gloss over some of these things. So if you have more questions, please follow up with us afterwards. So fashion at the end of the 18th century is very structured. The corsets are really pushing the body into a desired form. There's a lot of whalebone. The torso is being pushed into a cone-like shape. The skirts are very full and may be supported by what were called hoops at the time. We call them sometimes paniers today. And the robe a la Polonaise, which is on the left, is being supported by such hoops that you see at the very top of the screen. The robe a l'anglaise, which is to the far right, is being supported by the corset on the bottom. So this is kind of like the very end of the 18th century and what we're right about to step away from.
So children's fashion actually didn't change all that much during the course of Susan Wheeler's life. But just as adult clothing was reflecting these changes, these political and aesthetic changes in their ideas, children's clothing had been reflecting a revolution in ideas of its own. Prior to the 18th century, children were basically seen as miniature adults, and they were dressed as such. And but from about the mid-18th century and onwards, you start getting this change in attitude, new ideas about childhood as a period of innocence that right before the hardships of adulthood came over that should be preserved and protected by the family. And these ideas were beginning to take hold, and children's fashion reflected this. And while children's clothing certainly mirrored the trends that adult clothing, that was seen in adult clothing, you start to see styles that are distinctly for children during this time period. Now, like every child, boy and girl alike, until about four or five, Susan Wheeler, would have been in dresses. After that age, boys would be what they called breeched, or they'd put breeches or pants on, with younger boys wearing what was called a skeleton suit. And you'll see the boy in the center of the picture there is wearing the skeleton suit. Now, girls continued, of course, to wear dresses. Children's gowns were very simple and very practical. To accommodate growth, there was a drawstring around both the neckline and the waistline. And to accommodate growth in height, there were you could put tucks, which are basically decorative folds at the base of the hem. And you can just barely see in this picture, those white lines towards the end are kind of representative of those growth tucks. Just to give you an idea of the practicality of this garment, my now 5-year-old, since we have started bringing her out with us, she has gone through 5 modern children's clothing sizes. I have only had to make her 2 dresses. And I'm convinced that if I had cut the skirts longer and put more growth tucks in her first, she would still be in that one. So very, very practical clothing. And this is just another example of that very simple style. Children would also, both boys and girls, be put into stays. This is a pair of child's stays, which is dated about 1810. And as Heather is going to be showing you shortly, this very closely resembles the sort of stays that would have been worn by an adult woman. They aren't boned, they're just corded, they're very flexible, but they do aid in posture and serve, at least for girls, to get her used to the way that the stays support the body, much like a training bra does today for young girls.
As Susan Wheeler would get dressed in the morning, she's now about 1800, she's about 25 years old. She's a lady of fashion. And so I'll show you some of the stays that would have been worn around the end of the 18th century and then moving into the early 19th century and then rounding up with 1820, which is a little bit later. So the first thing she would have put on in the morning was her shift. And a shift is just a simple linen or cotton or linen-cotton blend garment. It's like your underwear. It's your base layer, protects your clothing from sweat. And it would be just a simple square neckline or a scooped neckline. Could have a drawstring, might not. It just depended. And that's pretty much going to stay the same. There's really not much innovation on the shift. The only difference between a early 19th century shift and one in the 18th century is that the sleeves would be shorter. They might not be gathered at the ends. And that's pretty much it. In fact, I would imagine some people might have even just taken their 18th century stays and just cut the arms off and they're ready to go. The shorter sleeves would have accommodated the chemise dress, the shorter style that was coming into fashion. The first set of stays, which is in the middle top here, is commonly referred to as a transitional stays. I'm not sure they really used that term back then, but that's kind of what we call it now. And if you remember the slide I showed earlier of the chemise à la reine and the beginnings of the open robe, that would have been a perfect stays to wear underneath that style to give the desired form. And stays in this period are very different than other time periods. They're not trying to force the body into a different shape. They're trying to support and give structure to the garment that's going to go over the top. And so in the beginning, they really just kind of are there to give the desired shape for the garment and not to restrict. It's actually quite comfortable. I myself today am wearing a pair of short stays. Stacy today is pairing a pair of long stays, and I think we're pretty comfy. They fit, if they fit well, they're comfortable. and then going to the bottom here is a set of French silk short stays that would be very early in the period. Probably for a younger person with a slighter figure, and there were some cases where people did not wear stays, but really I think that was mostly the people in upper society in France, and probably not so much over here in the United States. So there's different applications of the style depending on where people are located, whether they're in France, England, or the United States. And there's a lot of things you could delve into there, but we don't have time for a lot of details, so good for further study. The long stays at the very top right, you can see are very similar to the ones that are on the bottom right. The only difference, if you notice, is that the waist on the bottom right of the stays is wider and a little shorter, and there's a little more structure, there's more cording in it, and that's because it's moving into a style later in the 1820s where the waist is starting to drop, a little more of a cone-shaped skirt. So that's the only difference. But again, pretty nuanced between the different styles. After she would have put on her stays, she may have put on a petticoat. There's lots of different styles of petticoats actually in this period. There's three examples up here of a bodice petticoat, but I just want to say that it was more common to have this one on the left, which was just a skirt basically, and it would be held up with a couple of straps, and those appear more often in collections, but the ones to the right are very popular and we all see them a lot, and they're very pretty, so we'd like to include those as well. So a petticoat would have given a little layer of modesty with those very thin muslin gowns. The pink one that you see in the center right is made of silk, and you can imagine the beautiful effect it would have had underneath a white embroidered gown. It would have really showcased the embroidery very well at a ball or an evening party. And then others were just made of simple cotton or linen, made for everyday wearing. As she's dressed and ready to go, she's ready to meet Stephen.
Now you know what went under the gowns. Let's talk about the types of dresses that Susan Wheeler would have worn during the course of her courtship with Stephen. Now, the story goes that November of 1805, Susan Wheeler was part of a boating party which went out to Decatur's ship, the Congress, after his return from the Mediterranean. And Decatur was ashore at the time. However, the party was given a tour of the ship, and supposedly, as Susan went into the captain's cabin, what should catch her eye but a miniature of this miniature portrait of this very dashing, heroic captain, Stephen Decatur. Now, on such a trip, she would have been wearing a very fashionable day dress like those seen in this slide. Now, this picture is dated 1804, just a few months before, or a little more than a year, actually, before Susan would have met Stephen Decatur. Now, American women were certainly concerned with what was going on fashion-wise across the pond. They tended to defer to French fashion for historical reasons, but they did definitely make them, adapt them to make them suitable for American tastes. Now the day dress, it can go by many names, a variety of day dresses, such as the promenade dress, walking dress, afternoon dresses. They're all kind of the same type of dress. They were meant to be seen by others. And as you can tell from this picture, the dominant color in the first part of the early 19th century was white. Although it's not the only color that was worn, the white dress during this period was perhaps even more ubiquitous than the little black dress of today. You can clearly see the Grecian influence in this, not only in the garment, but in the styling of the hair. The preferred fabrics were very, very light. They would wear muslin, which is not like the muslin that we would purchase in the fabric store today. It was more like a voile or a very fine batiste that we would find, or sarcenet, which is a very light silk, were among the most often used by those who could afford them. Cotton was also coming into vogue during this period as well. Now, you can see these trains, they're not terribly practical. They started disappearing around by 1810, but there were other clever features to the gown. I don't know if you can tell on this, I guess she's the third lady. She kind of looks like the second. She's in profile for us here, lady from the left. You can see the top of her sleeve, and then about at her upper arm you see a band, and then the sleeve continues down. That's very indicative of a false sleeve. Basically what that is you have your short sleeve, and then the length from just above the elbow all the way down, is just basted in. And for a different occasion, she could remove those stitches, remove those basting, and transform her long-sleeved gown to a short-sleeved gown quite quickly. You see that the ladies are all wearing gloves, and one accessory that we can be certain that Susan would have been wearing out of doors was her bonnet. And you can see how the variety of bonnets that are going on here. This is the time where we are starting to get what, when someone says bonnet, we're starting to get that the shape of a bonnet that we picture usually when someone says bonnet. You'll see shawls are very popular, not only for their what they are as a status symbol, but to keep out the chill. Remember, very light, airy gowns, as well as to add a color contrast. If it had been a little cooler, perhaps Susan would have been wearing one of these, which is a Spencer jacket. It's so called because, apocryphally, the Earl Spencer supposedly burnt the tails off of his coat while his back was to a fire. Now, regardless of the truth of this story, this short jacket reigned supreme during this time period as perhaps the most popular piece of outerwear, basically through the first 2.5 decades of the early 19th century. Susan's actual meeting of Stephen, of course, did not occur on the ship that day. It was actually the next day at a party, dinner, and a ball that was hosted by her father to honor the naval hero. And so let's take a look at what she would have worn to something like that. Fabrics for evening attire would have been even finer, with muslins and silks being the most popular choices. Muslins in particular tended to be heavily embroidered, like this one in the middle, or the second one from the left. Because these gowns were being shown during the evening, remember this is a time before electric lighting, you're in dim candlelight, light colors tended to be preferred. Now, if you were an older married lady, you might take on darker colors, but particularly if you were young, as Susan was, you would have deferred to the white colors, or the light colors, and you might even accent your gown with spangles, which are basically an early 19th century version of a sequin, or metal trim or glass or crystal beading to catch the candlelight. You can imagine how spectacularly some of these gowns were. Sleeves on evening attire were almost universally short. Elbow length sleeves were fashionable around the close of the 18th century and first few years of the early 19th century. But short sleeves would have been paired with what we would call opera length gloves or elbow length gloves, and these would not have been taken off except to eat. You would have danced with those as well. Now, in contrast to the sleeves, the trains on these dresses in the early 19th century were very long. And this train gradually disappeared by the close of the first decade of the 19th century. I imagine someone eventually figured out it's not terribly practical to have a long train in a ballroom. Formal evening events were also a chance to show off your favorite baubles. Jewels, precious gems, were favorite in Europe, but pearls and coral tended to be considered more appropriately American at the time. Another essential accessory in the ballroom was a fan. Dancing was hot work. So you wanted to make sure to have your fan on you. And they were also a chance to make a statement. There was often classical or even political imagery on these fans. And these too could be bedecked in spangles to catch the light. Well, we can be assured that Susan caught Decatur's eye that night, because the following March in 1806, the couple were married. We can guess that Susan wore white, but not because of any bridal tradition. Most of the wedding traditions that we have now, we can thank the Victorians for. But basically because white tended to be the most popular color of gown in this period. And brides at this time simply wore their nicest day dress, whether that was one that they already owned or one that they had had made for the occasion. So it wasn't uncommon for brides to see brides in colors other than white, as you can see on the far right. All of these gowns are gowns picked from 1806. They were worn as wedding gowns. It was also expected that these wedding gowns would come out again. You weren't going to put them in a box and store them away in the attic somewhere. A bride would wear these dresses on the next possible occasion. Being married was a big step in a woman's life, and it's a status change, and she wanted to make sure people knew that, and that was reflected in the clothing as well.
Susan is now married. She's received in her wedding trousseau, she's got these jewels, these beautiful dresses, her wedding gown, evening gowns, but when she's home in the morning, she has a lot of duties. She's running the household, she may be writing letters, and here are some examples of things that she might have worn in the morning. The example on the left and the middle right are robes, so they would have been very easy to get in and out of. She might have put her undergarments on and then put on her robe. She could kind of get around the house. It was very comfortable style, and then she could easily put on her dress if she were going out for the day. The example in the middle left is from a little bit later, about 1815, and that would have been a day dress that you could wear out visiting a friend. You could also put on, show you my examples. I have props. So she would also have worn a cap, and this was a signal that she is now married. Isn't it so? It's a little frumpy to our modern eyes, I think. But caps were a way of really expressing oneself, and certainly when women were married, they really took this opportunity to show off their needlework, to show their personality a bit. You can see the cap in the top right has got these little inserted poofs on the back of it, and it gets pretty wild in the 1820s and 30s. The caps get even crazier, and if you've seen the adaptation of Pride and Prejudice and Mrs. Bennet and her crazy frilly caps, in some cases that probably wasn't far from the truth, except maybe a little bit later than the movie shows. She might also, if she's going out for the day, might put on a chemisette, which is basically like a modern day dickie, a false collar, or she could have used just a simple fichu or a handkerchief to kind of give a little modesty to her dress. And if she was just going over to see a friend, she might just keep her cap on and pop on her hat. Why bother taking off the cap? A little funny looking. But if she thought she was going to take her cap off, she would not keep on this before she left the house. She would have just gone with the hat, put on a pair of gloves, Probably would have brought a reticule, which is a very small bag, because this style, you didn't have pockets. And so the under pockets that you might have seen had space for in the 18th century would kind of show, you'd look like you had a little, you know, you were taken off with somebody's wallet or something if you were walking around with that in your pocket. But so they did persist a little bit, but for the most part, the reticule, which is this little bag, we have some examples out on the table, was what you would carry your things in. So you might go over to a friend's house to sew or visit, you might bring little things in there. The other thing that Susan, during this period of time, she wrote a lot of letters. And one thing that happened was she wrote, decided, she was very, she and Stephen were very in love. They had a very, was a very close relationship. She had concerns about his health. She was worried about him being injured in the war. And she decides she's going to write directly to the Secretary of the Navy about her concerns for Stephen's health. Well, that probably wasn't the smartest career move or political move. So while she's sitting at this desk, she writes in 1811 to her friend, Dolly Madison, and basically says, you know, she has already written to her. Dolly writes back, doesn't mention anything about this guffaw, basically, that she has made. So she follows up again with another letter and says, you know, I have the goodness, my dear friend, to show this letter to Mr. Hamilton, that he may see that my husband does not consider himself entitled to any indulgence on the score of health. When he does, he will himself inform the Secretary of Navy. In the meantime, my fears are not to be regarded. So she's really concerned. She's trying to kind of work through the back channels. She's very politically savvy. And so there's this letter writing. So we don't have a lot of letters from her, but we know that she was very active politically. Women at this time were very politically active and very knowledgeable of what was going on in society and culture, political movements, and were expected to participate. Unfortunately, in 1820, Stephen dies in a duel. And I could go into more history of this, but basically it's a ridiculous duel, it's crazy. But unfortunately, he passes away. These are some mourning fashions of the 1820 to about 1825 period. A more sober example on the far left, the other two on the middle and the right are a little bit more of probably what would be called a half mourning style. So when you were, mourning wasn't as structured in the United States as it was in Britain. In Britain, if a royal died, there were prescribed periods of mourning and half mourning, and everybody was expected to wear bombazine, and you know, there were prescriptives. Little less structured here, but some of those mores would have been followed anyway. But women would go out after a certain period of time, and they would participate in social functions and balls. So the dress on the far right is a ball gown, an evening gown for mourning. The two in the middle could probably be crossovers. This is a fashion plate from Ackerman's that's showing a walking dress that's a mourning. Mourning with M-O-U-R-N dress. Also jewelry, hair, little mementos with hair woven in intricate patterns embedded into jewelry might have been worn after the mourning period was over, you know, sometimes for the rest of people's lives. There were lots of rings with sentiments on them and things. So it was really quite a regular part of society. And you know, certainly with the War of 1812, there was a lot of death, unfortunately. So people were probably in a perpetual state of mourning and would adapt the styles as they changed over the decades. So one other thing she's writing and possibly putting into use her status as a widow, she does not receive a pension from the Navy for two things. One, she doesn't receive a regular naval pension for Commodore Decatur's service, but she also doesn't receive the arrearages owed to him for this famous sinking of the Philadelphia, which he's become this national hero, and you know, he never gets the money and she never gets the money. It's not until literally an act of Congress, a resolution in Congress in 1837, that she's granted both of these things. She never actually gets the arrearage money. She gets the five-year pension money, but one note that I thought was indicative of her really great political savvy is in 1834 she promises to Georgetown University that she's going to give them all this money, which she hasn't come into yet. And so it was kind of, I had a chuckle thinking about how that was a great political move, because now all of the politicians in Washington are pressed to resolve this issue for her. So we don't have a record of that necessarily, but I wonder if that could have been taking place.